Hey everybody, let me remind you one more time about my new blueprint for success. It's a project I've spent months and months working on just to help you jumpstart your comedy career and beat the competition. Whether you want to do stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, radio, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or agent, Blueprint for Success will give you all the tools you need to take your career to the highest levels. With exclusive interviews, my top 50 commercial-free episodes from industry standard, one-on-one coaching with me, and unprecedented access into my knowledge and experience from over 40 years in this crazy business, I guarantee you that with Blueprint for Success, you'll become the creator you've always dreamed of becoming. No one's asking me to do this. I want to do it because I want to help you become truly undeniable. So just go to barrykatz.com, click on Blueprint for Success, and start your incredible journey today. I truly can't wait to work with you to help you change the trajectory of your comedy career forever.
It's one of those things where if you see magic in a room and we, you know, you actors read together and you do tests either on tape or in a room with a bunch of people and everyone has an opinion and you're looking for a chemistry and you're looking for a spark, you just never know. And literally they did that first scene and it was truly, it was one of those moments in your career you do remember. It was just undeniable.
All right, my guest today, I am incredibly excited about having him here because he's one of the most respected executives in the television business. You know, I first knew him when he was the president of Columbia Tristar, the merger with Sony. I knew him when he then went to Michael Ovitz's company, ATG. And I've also known him throughout incarnations of having his own company, partnering with Mitch Hurwitz, who created Arrested Development. And him and his wife have their own company, and now they are executive producers for the past 10 years of probably one of the most successful shows on television, Two and a Half Men. Please welcome everybody, a guy who really helped me a lot in my career, Eric Tannenbaum.
Thank you very much for having me, Barry. It's a pleasure to be here. Nice to see you as always.
All right. We got a lot to talk about. I wanted to just start with something that I thought would be really beneficial to people. Take me back a while ago before you were ever in this business. Tell me what you were doing before the instinct came over you. Like, hey, I'd like to be in the entertainment business. Was there a job you were doing? Were you in some job and you were like, God, I got to get into this business? And how did you make your way into your first job in the business? And what was that?
Brings back memories. Just looking out of your office, I'm looking up where I grew up, which is Beverly Hills, not that far. And my dad was in the business for years. I don't know if you ever knew my dad, but he was one of sort of the pioneer executives. He was the head of many studios. And when I was a kid,
I am old, but I'm
know,
not
but
that
you're
old. I have gout. I have gout right now, so pretty much I shouldn't have your dad.
And
you grew up in Beverly Hills.
I did, and
you went to Beverly Hills High School.
Looking at it right now.
Wow.
And so when my dad was at places like Paramount and Universal and did shows like Kojak and the Brady Bunch and the Odd Couple, I never really knew what he did, but I remember going to the set of the Brady Bunch and seeing that staircase that led to nowhere and being in the house and meeting all those people. And I loved the Odd Couple as a kid for whatever reason. And, you know, it was sort of always in the blood of the family, but I never really truly understood what it meant or what he did, because he wasn't the kind of guy to talk a lot about it. In those days, there was three networks and four studios, and he was one of the heads of those places. And yet, sort of, I kind of grew up around it. Always thought I was going to be in some capacity. He desperately did not want me to be in the entertainment business. He begged me to go be a lawyer, do anything but.
Why was that?
Just because he knew, you know, he wouldn't come home and talk about it, but he just knew how hard it was, you know, and he just knew that, you know, it's mostly, as you and I know, a business of disappointment and failure, you know, always pushing rocks up a hill. And
we're going to talk a lot about
right, but that's the nature of our business and the survivors. And I think he was one of them, you know, and he was in lots of different jobs, picked themselves off and dust themselves off. And he was a salesman, which is what you've been for your life and what I've been in different versions too. And he knew how to deal with people. And I think that is kind of the core of what we've both done for all of our business. You treat people well. Everybody liked my dad. Always said good things about him. But again, until I got a little bit older. And so when I came back in between college, I went to school back east. I worked at William Morris one summer.
What did you do at William Morris?
In the mailroom.
About the mailroom at William Morris, because for those of you who don't know, I remember a guy, a producer that I knew in New York. His name was Bill Persky.
Oh, sure. Famous writer.
And he's a famous writer, and he created, I believe, Kate and Allie. And
he was a friend of my dad's.
I once talked to him because he told me that he started in the William Morris mailroom, and the mailroom was like a breeding ground for some of the greatest people in the business. And he told me that on the set of Kate and Allie, two of the people from the mailroom that used to deliver scripts to him on the set were Barry Diller and Michael Ovitz. And he told me that even then, at 21-year-old kids, they scared him. You know, he could tell that they were going to be somebody who was going to do great things. And here you are. You worked in the mailroom, and you did great things.
Quickly found out is that I did not want to be an agent, but what I did find out is you were exposed as was the epicenter. I mean, it was the place, and it was all the, some people in the mailroom were 35 and 40 years old who had multiple college degrees and PhDs and doctors and gave it up to make $300 a week to go deliver mail to people. So you got to meet everybody. You got a sense of what everybody did. And there was all these departments. And I'd seen some of the higher up people there because my friends of my dad's that I met over the years, but it had really no idea what they did. But all of a sudden you're exposed to this great amount of activity and information and things. And I quickly decided it'd be much more fun to be what they called was dispatch. And dispatch was the guys that got to go with it, you know, drive around and take the scripts to people. But you also realize you were taking a lot of personal packages to stars and talent. You're meeting people and knocking on their door at all hours of the night. And so it was crazy. And then many people that I did this sort of internship are now still in this business in different capacities. And there's one agent today who will go nameless that was banned from the Disney lot because he shot a rubber band at the security guard. I mean, it was just all craziness and fun.
Tell me some of the big stars that you delivered scripts to, and like it might be like 3 a.m. or something. Tell me some of the people that you remember, like you're like, holy shit, I can't believe that I get to deliver to this guy.
I remember some of the Charlie's Angels. I remember David Hasselhoff. I remember those kinds of TV stars were iconic people. And a lot of times you had to get through someone to get through someone to get to a third person. But it was just crazy. And for a young kid who never done this, and so you're meeting and you're going to all the studios and you're going to all these directors and producers and stars' house. And it was just a fascinating experience. But what the knowledge that it gave me was, okay, you start asking them questions. I understand what an agent's role was, what a studio's role was, what a producer's role was. And all of a sudden you're starting to put, someone who had no experience, just starting to connect the dots and put the pieces together. That was my first summer job. My next real job was when I graduated college. I knew I wanted to do something. And my dad had a very dear friend named Ned Tannen, who was deceased, but he was one of the great film executives of all time and a lovely man. And I went to his office. I drove out there, and he's like, okay, great. You need to learn what happens on a set. And so you leave in 2 days. And 2 days later, he sent me to Florida to work on a very bad movie called The Whoopi Boys. I don't even know if it was ever released. In Florida, and I was going to be a PA, and basically you're working to 18 to 20 hours a day.
Explain to the audience what a PA does, because the PA on a movie set and a television set, it's one of the few things that are almost exactly the same. So
my first job was to basically do anything they told me to do, but this movie starred Paul Rodriguez, who went on to be a friend of mine, who was a famous comedian, but kind of a crazy guy at the time, the height of his fame, was to have to find him in the middle of the night because he'd have to be taken to the set at 5 a.m. He was just getting home. So you'd be in which club, and I'd have to go find him at these places. I'd never been to Florida in my life, so now I'm trying to navigate my way around Miami, finding out where Paul's going to be or whose bed he's going to be in or which place he's going to come from. There was a comedian actress named Marsha Warfield who was at the time on Night Court in it, and no one could find her. And so basically my job was having to round up the cast and wake them up at 4 or 5 a.m, which is none too pleasant, to try to get them down to the set. And then it's anything from copying scripts to getting food for the directors. And the director's girlfriend was in it at the time, and they were always fighting. It was just one of those kind of places. But I met a few producers that I liked, and people throughout. And I learned now what it's like to be on a set. You learn who's really in charge, looking at how many, what the script is and how it's changing, and watching all that kind of stuff. And I then realized I didn't really want to be on a set every day. That wasn't necessarily the thing for me, unless I was really going to be in a position of having some control. So that for me was goal number one. And I came back after that and looked for jobs and looked for jobs. And fortunately through a series of connections, but also a friend of my dad's, he sent me over to a fledgling company called New World Entertainment. And there was a young guy there who had just taken over the TV company named John Feldheimer, who fortunately for me ended up becoming a quasi-brother and a mentor and a father figure for me. And I ended up working with him for almost 20-some-odd years.
And John now runs, well...
He's the chairman of Lionsgate.
Chairman of Lionsgate.
You know, and the stock just hit a record-breaking number, and he's one of the great executives in the business. And I literally started by, you know, he says, I'll find something for you. And he says, kind of just go sit over here in the corner. And I took his cleaning to the laundry. I got his cars washed. I made sure, you know, that his flowers were in his house and all that kind of stuff. And slowly over the course of time, as I was just sitting around his office, he would say, he'd throw a script at me. Just read this and tell me what you think about it. Or, you know what, can you just call this guy back? Or, you know what, someone's coming in, just go sit. And over the course of time.
For those of you listening and watching, it's like, you know, when you're starting, it's sort of like a relationship between a woman and a man. Normally, what a woman wants in a relationship is she wants to feel safe. And when you're an assistant or somebody starting out with somebody that big, all they want to do is feel safe. They want to know that everything that happens, everything you touch is done perfectly the way they would want it, sometimes even better than the way they want it. And once they start feeling safe, they start throwing you certain little things and say, okay, I'll throw them the script. It's not life or death. And then if you come back and you bring something in that's great or say this is great and it is great, then he has more trust in you. And that's how it normally works. And so that's how you – so you knew instinctually right away to go the extra mile.
Absolutely. And as I said, I built that trust with him, and he had – had me be someone's assistant for a while, who worked for the company, who became a longtime friend of mine, but I was not a very good assistant and no one could read my writing. So I realized that wasn't the sort of thing. So I went back and just started spending time with John and really understanding. And he basically, what I didn't know because I wasn't aware enough at the time, was basically paying me to go to graduate school. I was getting to watch someone who was really good at what they do and learn and listen and be part of things. And he just trusted me and liked me and knew that I cared about it. And so I read every script that came to the door. I made sure I got to meet every single person, spent the extra hours of sort of doing the work that needed to be done to educate myself and to trying to sort of understand what this meant. And they were just starting a show called The Wonder Years at the time, which was a very expensive show that no one was period, no single camera. And this was a company, New World did not have a lot of money at the time, and they were spending a lot of money to deficit
that,
this
that
show.
That was Marlins and Black Marlins who created and Black. That. And Mark Hirschfeld, who was a guest on this podcast, was the casting director at the time.
Absolutely. And Neil and Carol, very talented people, but not ultimately, you know, people that wanted to collaborate that much with other people. So they just went off and wrote this script, and everyone thought it was brilliant. But at the time, this was a new company, and you know, they were, you know, their money was select. They were not a major studio with huge dollars to be able to spend and deficiting all these shows. But everybody thought there was something special there. And then we were doing a show called Sledgehammer, which again at the time was sort of groundbreaking. It was David Rashi as a sort of crazy kind of get smarty kind of character. And then they were doing a show called Tour of Duty, which was sort of a Vietnam show. They were shooting in Hawaii. And so all of a sudden all this sort of stuff was happening. There weren't that many people there. So I just was kind of given more and more stuff to do. And you know, I looked up, and by the time I was in my mid to late 20s, I was, you know, basically responsible for a lot of stuff. And we were out doing a lot of things. And then ultimately, as you know, the company was sold to Columbia, and we then sort of all moved together and you know, moved on to sort of running that place.
Hey, everybody. I hope you're enjoying this episode as much as I am. If you made it this far and you haven't fallen asleep yet, then you must be the type of person who's serious about having a career in the comedy business. That's why I'm offering you my Blueprint for Success, a one-of-a-kind all-access pass into my knowledge and experience after over 40 years of working with the best of the best in this crazy entertainment industry. I'll tell you all the stories, all the philosophies, give you all the great special guests, and even give you one-on-one private consultations to help you expand, enhance, and skyrocket your comedy career. Just go to barrykatz.com and click on Blueprint for Success to learn more about my groundbreaking digital academy that I've created just for you. With it, we can take your career so far that one day, instead of listening to this podcast, you'll be interviewed on it.
Tell me how you went from doing these multitasking roles at New World to becoming the president of Columbia TriStar and then Sony? How does something like that happen? How do you make the leap from somebody who's basically delivering scripts and delivering flowers and to people and chasing down Paul Rodriguez and Marcia Warfield to being the president, the guy who is running the joint?
It's a combination. There's no perfect answer, as you know. There's no science or exact path to any of these jobs. But I was fortunate enough to have somebody in John who over the years really started to trust me. And as he started to rise up the ranks, he felt he wanted someone that was an extension of him and yet had ideas of their own. And I was always interested in what those sort of ideas were. And our business, the TV business, is a really writer driven business, and it always has been. And so I really became interested in writers, and I cultivated relationships with every young agent in town and as many writers as I could. And I read every writer, and I was just interested in what they had to say. And then also interested in coming up with ideas and concepts and things that I felt like weren't done, you know, weren't on at the time. And as I said, no direct correlation other than I really cared about what I did. I worked really hard. And we started to have some success. I made a deal early on. There was a comedian named Paul Reiser who had just come off a show called My Two Dads. And, you know, I met with him and liked him. And an agent called me and said, you should meet him. And he wasn't the hottest guy in the world, but I really was a fan of his and thought he was funny.
And a lot of times, as you know, what's fascinating about stand-up comedians who become leads in sitcoms, one of the major statistics that's unbelievable is that there isn't one instance that I know of any stand-up comedian who got the lead in their own sitcom the show went to syndication, at least 100 episodes, that hasn't or hadn't been doing comedy at least 10 years. Right. It's like maybe you could say the Wayans brothers, but they weren't really doing stand-up at the time. So any Roseanne from, you know, Brett Butler to Paul Reiser to Seinfeld, Ray Romano, everyone, a minimum of 10 years.
Perfecting their craft.
And a lot of times, the people that you make deals with who are comedians are not the hottest people. The hottest comedians are rarely the ones that can get a show going. Right. It's the ones that are gutting it out. It's not that they're not respected. It's just that they've gutted out. They have a point of view, which is the most important thing, which I want you to talk about. And they're normally the ones that will make the hit show.
And that point of view word is such an often overused word, but it really is true. And the guys that had really had something to talk about that was in them and personal to them. There's a lot of funny people, and we've all been to the clubs, and you're the expert of all experts on this, and you know talent. But then when someone really, if you feel like they have something to talk about and a subject matter that interests them. And so I had met with Paul and I liked him and knew him from his other show, but was never, you know, wasn't a benchmark kind of show. And he came in, I'll never forget, and he shut the door and he said, I just got married. And he said, we went on this great honeymoon, and I came back and I shut the door to my new house. So I walked in, I looked at my wife, and I realized, holy shit, that's the rest of my life. And he said, that's the show I want to do. I want to show when you make that decision, you come home and you then all of a sudden now you're looking down the barrel of, oh, wait a minute, it's just us. And now what? There's no handbook for it. There's no whatever told you how to do it. And now you two people have to sort of say, this is our life together, and you got to create this life. And thought, wow, that's a great place as a jumping off point for a show. And he really wanted to do it as a little movie every week and a little play. And we had huge arguments because at the time nobody was doing really single camera shows, and they weren't working. They were, you know, people wanted to do sitcoms, but Paul was so scarred from coming off My Two Dads, think it wasn't the quality that he had signed on for, that he wanted to do the show like, you know, in that single camera way with, you know, without a laugh track and all that stuff. And we fought. And it took almost 2 years to get the show developed. And we finally did it. We brought in a great writer named Danny Jacobson, who was a brilliant mind. But not till the 100th episode party did Paul lean over. He's not a big guy to say, well, thank you. We're not one of those. That's just not who he is. And he pulled me aside and said, I just want to say thank you. This was years later. I'm like, what? He says, you convinced me to do this as a sitcom, and it made it great. And so that was his acknowledgement of, you know, that at least on some one occasion I was right.
And so at that point in time, you know, we talk about the failures and the disappointments. But what's kind of fascinating, your career up to that point, from when you started as a PA up until then, not a lot of disappointment, not a lot of failure. So your career is on kind of a roll. And even though your dad had told you, listen, I don't want you in this business because I know You know, what's that thing from Batman? Decent people shouldn't live here.
Right.
So you have this thing where things are going really well and there's not really anything you're sort of saying to yourself, hey, man, this business is a piece of cake, man. It's just one thing. I'm rising. I'm the president. So tell me about the first time you got your legs taken out from under you and where you really you realized, holy shit, this business will squash you like a f-ing bug.
I had this idea at the time. I was living, during all this time, there was a very hot radio show in Los Angeles, and they're still on the air. Their names are Mark and Brian. I don't know if you remember these guys.
Yes, of course.
And looking back on it now, we were actually really ahead of the reality curve when no one was doing it, but I was just a fan. I listened to these guys every day driving to work. And I thought, I'm just going to go meet them. I'm going to call them up. They don't know me. They don't have an agent. I'm just going to go. And I tracked them down and I got to become friends with them and go watch their radio show. And I said, hey, there's a TV show on you guys. And this is nobody was doing any kind of reality stuff, certainly no comedy reality. And somehow I sold this show and I put it together. And I got all these pieces together and it was called The Adventures of Mark and Brian on NBC. And it was a huge deal. The funny part of the show was, I remember on a Saturday morning, Brandon Tartikoff, the late genius, and all of his people came over to screen the
pilot. Talk about, just real briefly, to explain to our audience, Brandon Tartikoff, what he was doing at the time, because I think it's important.
Brandon was the chairman of NBC and one of the true great pioneers in the history of the television business.
And
a visionary.
A very young man
and a wonderful human being and an executive. And, at the time they were doing shows like Cheers and Hill Street Blues. I mean, that's quality. And somehow we snuck this little offbeat comedy of two guys who weren't actors that were going around doing crazy stunts and we're going to get a TV show on NBC. And we screened the pilot at New World on like a Saturday morning. All they came over, Brandon and all his team. And I remember I was in the bathroom in New World and I was in the stall and he walked in and he didn't know I was there. And he and some executives were in there and I heard him say, holy shit, these guys have no talent. What are we going to do with this? And like literally that moment, I thought my career was over. And somehow they put the show on.
Did you walk out of the stall?
One of those things. I spent everything. This was like my thing. I was so proud of him. So excited. This is getting on NBC. And these guys, and I love them. And I just literally at that moment, every ounce of you is deflated because the guy, and yet even when he said they have no talent, the show's terrible, we're going to put it on the air. And he did. And of course it died. That was the moment where I literally thought, okay, this is not going well anymore. I got to reevaluate.
That's
it's the nature of our business.
What a great story. Can you just real briefly go back and tell me about the casting of the Paul Reiser experience?
Yeah, it was one of those things.
I think that's something that could be interesting for people.
So it was one of those things when you're writing a script with somebody and for somebody, and as I said, a great writer and a good friend named Danny Jacobson and Paul, and it took some time for them to sort of get together and create this show, but they're two guys writing the show, and clearly the Paul character was really well defined and we were kind of trying to figure out who was going to be the woman. And it was still kind of under the radar, a small idea, but it was also set up at NBC and they loved the idea of it, but it was only about if we could find that magic. And I'm totally blanking out on her name, of course, what I will think of in a second. The woman from Lois and Clark was in Desperate Housewives. Oh my God, I can't believe I can remember her name. Will come to me in a second. Was the woman that everybody wanted for the show. And we took her to NBC to read the scene, but we also someone had said, with bringing a second person, there's this, young actress named Helen Hunt, and she had done this like TV movie about like high school cheerleaders, football players. Like she hadn't done that much, but everyone thought she was a great actress, but she was really kind of there to be the stalking horse and not be the one.
And I think this is important to talk about the process of how these people get to the position of the studio and the network. And again, an unknown actress versus a 800-pound gorilla who's basically an actress who's done like hundreds of episodes of television, and what it takes for somebody to knock you guys on your asses and say, holy shit, I don't care that person's done 300 episodes of television. This is the person.
And it's one of those things where if you see magic in a room and we, you actors read together and you do tests either on tape or in a room with a bunch of people and everyone has an opinion and you're looking for a chemistry and you're looking for a spark. And literally the second, and we had, for whatever reason, we hadn't really seen Helen do it before with Paul, but we'd all liked her and we thought she's very appealing and she seemed so honest and that girl next door and everybody could fall in love with her, but you just never know. And literally they did that first scene and it was truly, it was one of those moments in your career you do remember. it was just undeniable. With it, just the two of them, you felt like this was a couple that could survive the test of time, that you just knew those people were so deeply connected. And it was Terry Hatcher, was the woman I couldn't remember before, who was a big TV star and still is. And everybody said, it's Terry and Paul, and that's just it, and we're done, but we just have to see it. And again, the dark horse came in, being an unknown person, but it was undeniable to the 20-some-odd people in that room.
Which is one of my favorite expressions, right? Undeniable, and, because I feel if you can create that, you can't
lose. You have a shot. And you know, one of those things, that the rest is history, but they were just so good together, and we were able to do that show that really was small and intimate. And every person who talked to us about the show over the years later was always, the comment was, oh, that's me and my wife. Oh, my boyfriend and girl, you know, just had that conversation. Well, we had those similar kind of feelings and circumstances. And I think that's a big part of TV. And again, it's, if you can connect to people and relate to them, you have a chance to have a hit.
Yeah. And tell me some of the other shows you worked on at Sony and Columbia TriStar that really made an impact on the country and the world.
I don't know about the country or the world, but we had some success. You know, I had a great, really fun experience with Fran Drescher and putting The Nanny together. And at the time was a very successful show, and she very strong going back to point of view, and she knew who she was and what she wanted to do. And she wanted to be, you know, that kind of Auntie Mame kind of character. And it was a show that ran for 7 or 8 years and was a lot of fun.
Where did you find Fran?
She had done a few things and, had come to us for a meeting. And again, it was just someone that who really knew who she was, and she knew how to market herself. And she wanted to play that fantasy character, fish out of water, the poor girl in the big house and taking care of the kids. And it was the right idea for her. And it was the right time for the show, and brought friends of mine in to write it and create it with her, and that they were all really connected and clicked. And we had a really good run. A few years later, I was introduced to a comedian named Kevin James, who was kicking around. I'm sure you knew him over the years.
Another example of a comedian been doing it over 10 years, had been a great college comedian, had a tremendous routine that, to me, I love so much about pantomiming the getting a card for a girl in the store. It was just an amazing piece. But again, a guy who wasn't out there, and it wasn't a household name, but a person who had a real point of view.
And he was in a deal at NBC, and I had made a deal with the writer, another friend of mine, a very talented guy named Michael Whitehorn, is one of the great writer-producers in the business, and he wrote this thing called The King Queens, and he wanted to write it for Kevin, and it was just really complicated because we were supposed to make it at NBC, but NBC did not want to make it, and I really believe in the show, and spent a lot of money to get it out of NBC and got CBS to say, hey, we'll take a shot on this guy and this script, and, you know, it was a kind of a flyer. But it was just one of those things where you sort of knew that sort of blue collary guy, a little bit of the anti-hero, you know, kind of thing. And you put him with a woman who maybe he married a little bit over his head and, you know, kind of thing, but he loved her. You know, and the reason why that show, I think, really worked, besides it being funny and Kevin was a huge talent, is he loved that woman and wanted to do anything to make her happy. And it goes back to the Flintstones model. It was that same kind of thing. And, you know, these shows tend to work when you have great actors, but there has to be a writer at the center, but who has a vision for what the story they want to tell. And Michael did, and Fran and her people did, and Danny and Paul did, and those are the shows. And I've been fortunate enough to be involved, you know, with Two and a Half Men, and Chuck did. And those are the ones that sort of have legs and can continue because they have something to talk about.
One of the things that, if you're a comic listening, that was heartbreaking about the business having to do with King of Queens, I remember that the pilot episode of King of Queens, the father was Jack Carter.
It was.
And Jack Carter was a legendary stand-up comedian, hadn't done that much acting, but still had done some work. He was probably close to 70 or over 70, and for him, this was one of the greatest opportunities of his career. And so you have a guy who had a long, prestigious career, and one final hurrah, goes in, does the pilot, has all great intentions, everything wonderful. This is the way to go out. I'm going to go out on top. And why don't you share what happened?
You know, sadly, unfortunately, it happens a lot. It was a cast that they loved. And from the very beginning, Les and everybody had wanted.
Les Moonves,
a chairman of CBS and a friend and a mentor, and he'd always had a vision of what he wanted for the show, but we couldn't get Jerry Stiller because Seinfeld was just kind of coming to a close, and he didn't want to work that hard, and he wanted to live in New York and be back with his wife, and we tried and we tried and we tried. We couldn't cast the part. At the end, everybody just sort of pushed through the idea of Jack Carter, who was an icon, a legend, and a funny man. But it was, well, I'll never forget the night of the experience. It was a very close friend of mine, a director named Pam Fryman, who's one of the top directors in the business and incredible. The loveliest person, incredible success. We were there till 4:30 in the morning trying to get the performance and Jack and get his lines. It was just one of those things that everybody looked up and said, if we go to series, I don't think we can do this every week because it'll kill everybody. And
because he didn't have his lines memorized.
It just wasn't clicking. It just was one of those things where you sort of saw the greatness and the chemistry of Kevin and Leah and how funny and that piece. It felt like it was in a little bit of a different universe. So you kind of knew that night that we were going to get that call that, hey, we'll do this, but guess what? We're going to replace it. And when we knew the series was going to be picked up, it enabled us to go back and make a deal with Jerry. And originally he was only going to do a certain amount of episodes, but as you know, when artists tend to fall in love with something and they become something and it feels natural to them, then they tend to want to do it more. And that's how that show happened. And we had to go back and reshoot the whole pilot, but in the long run, 8 or 9 years later, it worked out.
And that's the lesson is that you when you go and just because you get a gig, just because you get a job doesn't mean you have the job because you got to go to the pilot. It's like literally the NFL, you win your division and you're like, hey, we won the division. Oh, we have to play the wild card game. And then you play the wild card game, you're like, we won. And then you're like, okay, we have to play the next game until the Super Bowl. And you're in the Super Bowl. Hey, we haven't won the Super Bowl yet. And every time you go into any job, if you're an artist listening, no matter how old you are or how young you are, if you're an executive, every second, every frame, every moment that counts, you have to make count.
I think it's really important. And, a big part of our job is we do, a lot of casting things and a lot of our new shows and pilots, and you do table readings, you do auditions, and you have to bring it every time because, unfortunately, there's so much pressure on these things and the value and the price to get these things happening. And so, unfortunately, so many actors get replaced after table readings and run-throughs because they're sort of saving it and waiting, waiting for a tape night.
A very famous story is news radio. Ray Romano was cast in his first television role as the maintenance guy in news radio. And he went to the table read. After the table read, got the call that he was fired and he was replaced with Joe Rogan. Mm. So comedians oftentimes experience a lot of, and again, the disappointments and the failures. What's amazing about our business is at the time when you look at it, completely devastating. But then when you look at where your career is after that, like Ray and what happened to him, you almost want to send a fruit basket to the people.
worked out okay for him.
At news radio, because it worked out okay.
As always, this has been Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. And if you like the show, tell all your friends. And if you don't like the show, tell all your friends.
You get out! Fancy car, all the people love you, 'cause you're going far. Life is for the dreamers, they have all to gain. It's never quite over till it all feels the same. You pick your fortune.
Thank you for listening to Industry Standard with Barry Katz. If you'd like more info on our schedule of new episodes or how to reach Barry through Twitter, Facebook, or email, go to barrykatz.com. Before you leave, please take a moment to subscribe to our podcast, leave a comment, and rate it, even if you think it blows. Thank you for your support, and have a great day.
Hey, everybody. Let me remind you one more time about my new blueprint for success. It's a project I've spent months and months working on just to help you jumpstart your comedy career and beat the competition. Whether you want to do stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, radio, social media influencing, Or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or agent, Blueprint for Success will give you all the tools you need to take your career to the highest levels. With exclusive interviews, my top 50 commercial-free episodes from Industry Standard, one-on-one coaching with me, and unprecedented access into my knowledge and experience from over 40 years in this crazy business, I guarantee you that with Blueprint for Success, you'll become the creator you've always dreamed of becoming. No one's asking me to do this. I want to do it because I want to help you become truly undeniable. So just go to BarryKatz.com, click on Blueprint for Success, and start your incredible journey today. I truly can't wait to work with you to help you change the trajectory of your comedy career forever.